This is the second panel discussion as part of a series of webinars hosted by the Press Institute of India and UNICEF on behalf of Sashi Nair, Sugata Roy and Sushmita. A very warm welcome to all of you. You almost heard the bell ringing, of course. When was the last time we heard that bell ringing? To set the tone here, ladies and gentlemen, here's an improvised song of Pink Floyd, Another Brick in the Wall. This one, of course, rechristened Another Window on Zoom, produced by Ifat Ogad. We don't want a copyright strike, so we're giving due credit. So I think there's an audio problem. I think we'll skip this. Pardon me, I keep thinking that I'm still in NDTV and we expect a full-fledged production control room, but that's fine. That was actually a spoof of Pink Floyd's number. You know, ladies and gentlemen, Mark Twain had once quipped, "I never let my schooling interfere with my education." Today, we are asking ourselves, are we letting online education interfere with the health of our children, both physical and mental? Corona and cornered the impact of the lockdowns on the health of children. Ladies and gentlemen, BHOCK, that's a new real estate acronym, bedroom, hall, office, classroom, and kitchen. And this evening, we've roped in all the right experts and stakeholders to take us through this discussion. We have three doctors, all eminent doctors. We've got Dr. P. Purnachandrika, who is a professor and head of the Department of Psychiatry at the Institute of Mental Health. We've got Dr. Mohan Rajan, chairman and medical director of Rajan Eye Care. Dr. P. Madhu, consultant pediatrician and chairman of Glanis Institute of Medical Sciences, Madurai. Old student of Harvard. We've got Neelakantan, affectionately known as Neelu to all of us, theatre personality, also governing body member of the Madras Seva Sadan, the Bruns, Lady Andal and Sir Mutha schools. We've got Nandini Sridhar, who's a parent and also here in her capacity as a special educator. And the most relevant stakeholder of them all, we've got Parth Haryan Kaushik, a student of PSPB KK Nagar. Thank you very much for joining us. I want to go to Parth first. I want to go to Aryan first. Aryan, you're somebody who's changed schools bang in the middle of the lockdown and the pandemic. I think you've come from Salem to Chennai because of your father's transfer. Your father, of course, is a senior police officer. Tell us, what are the changes you've experienced? You know, the difference between going to school, meeting your friends in class, and actually watching them, seeing them across the computer screen. Aryan?
I'm just thinking where to start and where to end. And it has been a very dramatic 1.5 years that we have been sitting in at our homes. And then now finally the schools have opened. And then actually we have started going to schools now. And it's not like a complete school, I would say, not those usual 9 to 4 timings. It's just those 2-3 hours at school and then coming home and just studying all those subjects which you term as languages like English and Hindi. And I really missed, seeing all my friends and my teachers. And learning in online technology in like online classes was totally different from what it is offline. And I
feel what has it done to your health, Aryan? Have you fallen sick during this period? Have you put on weight? I'm seeing you wearing glasses. Are you wearing glasses only now?
Yeah, the last time. Yes, uncle.
His power has gone up.
I'm just wondering because the last time I interacted with him on Zoom, he wasn't wearing glasses. So I'm wondering if this is a direct fallout of the lockdown.
Yeah, you can say so, sir. These glasses, I just recently bought them because the screen and the blue light of the screen started hurting me so much that I had to, compel my mother to just take me along and buy me the glasses. Of course, a smart pair of glasses. And I have put on a lot of weight and I've seen a lot of my friends putting on a lot of weight and I'm still struggling to, you know.
Of course, the only consolation is that there are no school uniforms to fit into now. But of course, I think you have to, you started going to school, right? 10th standard?
Yes, sir. I have started going to school.
Okay, Dr. Purnachandrika, Doc, thank you for joining us. The mental health of children, I mean, we hear a lot about this. A lot is being talked about, a lot of reports in the newspapers. There was a recent survey also done by experts in Chennai. What are the red flags, doctor, that parents should look out for when it comes to mental health of their children? What are the first signs of something going wrong?
Yes, sir. Good evening, sir. It's nice to be sharing a platform with you. We have seen you on TV, and to sharing the platform with you itself is... I'm still thinking I am on NDTV.
Yeah, you are on NDTV, actually. This is a make-believe world, so...
That's why I told initially technology scares me.
I know. It scared all of us long today. But talk, the red flags, what are the initial warning signs that parents should look out for?
I always say that just one example of what the teachers said during an online classes. In one school, the teachers always used to, when the students were attending offline, the teachers used to say, don't say good morning, miss. That looks so silly. Don't ever do that. But once during an online session, one of the teachers said, please, children, please, all of you say that at least once to me. I'm missing you all. That was how it was started. So the teachers miss. And of course, as you say, sir, the red flags, it differs across ages. It differs across ages. Young toddlers, even young toddlers have it. So children and adolescents, the pre-existing mental health issues will be exacerbated. And the social inequality itself, I can even cite various ways. And then another one thing is the children actually get glued to it, and that leads to excessive viewing and excessive online gaming, which increases due to this. And again, if suppose the child shows some, the adolescent shows some excessive irritability, and we also should think of reasons which are associated with COVID, wherein the child will have excessive fear and anxiety, and it is normal to have a children experience fear and anxiety. If there are no other underlying signs or symptoms, it is just reassure them that it is normal to have some fear and some anxiety when initially during the first wave when these online classes started. But after that, the red flags for the parents should be when the child is having, when it's an adolescent and when they are having a sleep problems. And of course, an adolescent, they always will go against the rules. So if they do not follow the rules, and if they do not follow the guidelines, and if they do not, if they say no for everything, and that is also one of the red flag signs.
If I can break this into two levels, ma'am, let's say children from ages 5 to 10 and 10 to 17. What are specifically the symptoms of some mental health issue cropping up? If you can give us in these two categories, a few symptoms.
The children 10 to 18, it will be mostly irritability.
Okay.
The irritability, the sleep disturbances, and if suppose the excessive eating behavior, what suddenly they go into this binge eating behavior and excessive irritability, the risk taking, the impulsivity. So that will be evident in the adolescents. Whereas in the children, it is more of fear, the excessive fear, the anxiety that will lead to excess clinging to parents. So at the time of this breaking down, and we are allowing offline classes, they might refuse to come out of their rooms. And I've had complaints wherein children are inside the rooms and are refusing to come out. And excessive, as usual, screen timing. Now that we are saying that we have to view through the laptop, you have to view through mobile phones. So excessive screen time itself is one of these symptoms nowadays in young children itself, because they are finding it now, it's legalized.
Absolutely. Let me go across to Dr. Mohan Rajan, a well-known eye doctor in Chennai. Doctor, thank you for joining us. Lack of sleep, is that directly attributable to the amount of screen time? Is that a direct fallout of that?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Let me congratulate Sanjay for this wonderful concept of getting this webinar, because I think it's important to raise the awareness among the public as well as the parents about what's the problem among the children. Not only the psychiatric, the behavioral issues, but also the problems in the eye, which is becoming a huge problem. I would say in the past 2 years, we have seen something like a myopia. It's one is the corona pandemic on one side. We are on the other side, we are seeing the myopia epidemic, which is growing in huge proportions. For example, before the pandemic, the incidence of myopia in children was about 15%. Now it has gone to 22% in the past 2 years.
Can you give us a layman's expression of the term myopia, doctor, for the benefit of
myopia? Myopia means short sight. Short sight means the children will not be able to see the distant objects. Okay. For example, what is on the TV, they'll not be able to see. So they go closer to the TV and watch. Okay. This myopia is directly proportional to the screen time. Please understand, because if they have a lot of screen time continuously for more than 1.5 hours, 2 hours, and then especially the smaller gadgets. That is why I'm advising all the parents to go for bigger gadgets. For example, the TV is bigger, better than the desktop. The desktop is better than the laptop. The laptop is better than the iPad or the tablet. The tablet is better than the smartphones. Please understand, the smaller the gadget, the more the strain on the eyes and more likely the myopia is going.
What about those who don't have, who have only small wallets? I mean, for especially for the, we're talking of the digital divide, especially in the rural areas where they can all just about manage one phone for the family and you have children having to make do with that.
No, very simple thing. What is important is they have to connect the phone by, it's not necessary that you have to, they need a smart TV for that. Any TV can be connected. You just need an Amazon Fire Stick or a Chromecast. Just connect your phone to the TV. Okay, that's what they're doing in the this thing also. So the bigger the screen, the better for the children. Because the smaller the screen, the gadgets, everything will go for a 6 as far as myopia is concerned. With myopia and also the another condition called keratoconus, because the children are constantly viewing the computers, there is a dryness in the eye. And also, they have a tendency to rub the eye. When the eye rubbing is directly proportional to a condition called keratoconus, wherein the cylindrical power or astigmatism, the cylindrical power is called astigmatism, that can go up. And the keratoconus can also set in. And we have also seen in the past 2 years, the incidence of keratoconus is also going up in children, mainly because of the eye rubbing, the dryness, and exposure to blue light, as Kaushik was rightly telling about that. And that is the reason why we asked them to go for a blue filter glasses. And more importantly, there are protocols which are being laid down by the American Academy of Ophthalmology. That is, up to the age of 3 years, no educational classes. Between the age of 3 and 7 or 8, you need to have about 90 minutes. Then after the age of 7 to 12 is about 180 minutes. To 240 minutes. Every 30, 40 minutes, you need a 10-minute break. During the 10-minute break, they have to do some physical activity or yoga or meditation, something totally different.
That's an important point you're making, doctor. So it means no continuous back-to-back classes. I think schools should take note of that. No back-to-back classes. Let me go across to Dr. Madhu Purushottaman. We'll come back to you, doc. Dr. Madhu, my classmate at Don Bosco and somebody who's studied at Harvard. Madhu, thank you for joining us. What are the immediate health concerns of children? Obesity, or is it vitamin D deficiency? Because many of them are not getting enough sunlight. They're all cooped up inside their homes. I know of several parents who are scared to let them play on the terrace as well. You go to the terrace and suddenly you find some neighbor coming up to take up the clothes or to dry clothes without wearing a mask. So there is that very tangible fear that's prevalent. So what are the immediate health concerns of children in your experience?
Yeah, thank you, Sanjay, for the opportunity to be a part of this wonderful webinar. Well, I mean, the truth of the matter is, unlike most infections, which hit children very hard, when it came to the COVID pandemic, it was very light on the children. And that was something that was very fortunate. And the most parts of the world, of course, the a percentage of children affected has varied, but nowhere it's gone beyond 2-3%. One of the syndromes that hit the children during the COVID pandemic was a syndrome called the multi-system inflammatory syndrome of COVID, MIST. Very minuscule, very small percentage of children were affected, and those are the children who landed in the ICU and ran into problems. But as I said earlier, the percentage of children affected with the multi-system inflammatory syndrome of COVID, MIST, was really minuscule. In most parts of the world, it was less than 1%. And for many of the children who did catch the infection, it was more of a hit and go. they just probably had fever for, you know, a few days, and hardly any of these children had to be admitted to the ICU.
Madhu, I think your audio is not very clear. Madhu, we'll come back to you if you can get it set right. Meanwhile, we'll go across to Nandini Sridhar. Nandini Sridhar, who's a parent and a special educator. Nandini, thank you for joining us. As a parent, what are your challenges in managing, coping with this pandemic and children's online education?
Online education, first and foremost, I mean, what is the value system we were teaching our kids and what is it now? You see, we've been trying to keep our children away from the online, the laptops and the telephones and the smartphones. And now suddenly we say, this is what we have to do. This is your way. And so they already, it's like, you know, the children start questioning the parents, why do we have to do this? And you used to say that we shouldn't be doing it, and now we have to do this, right? So that is one of the things that I face. And many of the parents, my friends, my neighbors would complain to me, what are we doing? You know, what are we doing to our kids? So that was one major thing. Two, the personal interaction with the teacher, okay? We are talking about children with no difficulties. What about special kids? Special children that who need personal attention. Now, how are we going to help them? How did we help them in these past 2 years during the pandemic? Because already they are in a state of confusion, surrounded by adults who don't understand what they are going through. And to top it is now this pandemic and then online education. So how it was very difficult for them to cope. You see, very difficult for them to cope. Then comes the academics, where children who couldn't study well couldn't further follow education teaching. Children who studied very well couldn't perform and really show their talents. You see, and they were all very disappointed with the results they received. So these are not a few of the challenges as a parent I met, and some of my friends also, in terms of online education. Yeah.
Okay. Since we're focusing on health, I want to go across to Neelu Neelakantan. As a governing body member, how have you managed the PT classes with the reopening of schools? Are they allowed to wear their masks during the PT drills or games? What are the precautions that you can possibly take? I know it's a tough one to answer. What are the precautions that you can take during your, you know, games or your PT periods in school? Neelakantan, can you hear me? I think you need to unmute yourself, Neelu.
My apologies. Thank you very much, Sanjay and UNICEF, for having me on this. Just to give you a background, our Madras Seva Sadhan actually runs about 7 different educational institutions, and I look after the sports and activities in all 7 of them. Now, to answer your question directly, in terms of PT, to be honest, we've actually been conducting PT classes online as well through this entire pandemic. The little bit you spoke when Dr. Mohanrajan had said about making them do yoga or physical exercises in between classes and stuff. We actually had a PT class for them online where the teachers were, PT masters were actually making them do physical exercises. Of course, the only problem is you are not certain you can enforce it, because we really don't know what's happening behind the screen. But as far as possible, we try to enthuse the children and make them take part. Now, physically, as you would say, in terms of, since the schools have reopened for the 9th, 10th, 11th, and 12th, there are no actual PT classes because they are following the same timing as they did online, right? So it's the same 3 hours.
You mean the schools that have reopened for classes 10 and above don't have physical PT periods in schools?
Not really. I don't think they do it yet.
Is it only your schools, or are you
in our schools? In our schools, what is happening is every time the lockdown was lifted, we actually had our cricket coaching open, we had our football coaching open, we had our basketball coaching open. All this was carrying on. Cricket matches were going on. We have a ground, so cricket matches were going on. And a lot of children kept coming. A lot of children came for football, a lot of children came for basketball as well. We restricted it to these 3 or 4 games only. And the response to that was fabulous. And a lot of the children who are into other things are asking us now, could you please restart that as well? Because we want to come out and start playing. We want to start doing our stuff. The main reason we are opening up these games is a lot of them are non-contact sports, right? Now you're playing cricket. There's a hell of a distance between a fielder and a batsman, a bowler and a batsman. They don't come.
You have a short leg and you have
Which is still about 3 meters away. Which is still about 3 meters away. So that so when you're running a match also, it's not just the case. You see some of the open age category matches also taking place.
When it comes to cricket, I think you'll have to probably ban using saliva on the ball.
Absolutely. That's been stopped entirely. Yeah, that's not just amongst us. I mean, internationally, that's a rule now. So you cannot do that. Now, where basketball and football are concerned, they can be mild contact sports when you're playing them. So we ensure that what we're actually doing with them are drills, which maintain the social distance. We follow the SOPs that are involved. So far, touch wood, we can say that we have not had any issues arise from the fact that all the children are in the schools playing. In fact, we have recently started up with one of our schools, which is the government-aided girls' school. We have started up cricket for the girls, and we have had about 50 girls sign up. And it's extremely heartening to watch them, far more than the students who are, shall we say, the haves versus the have-nots, as you say. The government-aided school, the Madras Seva Sadhus, all girls from, lower-income families. They are the ones who are far more enthusiastic about coming to school, coming to class, coming for the sports and everything than our other children who are, exposed to the smartphone.
That's so heartening. That's really so heartening. Let me bounce this off Aryan. Aryan, what are the games you used to play before the pandemic and what do you do now since the pandemic erupted?
In Salem, I was in my school football team, and before that, I was in Madurai. I used to play cricket, and almost I used to play all the sports. But now, we are just longing.
The football are gathering dust in the attic.
Exactly. And now all of us are just longing for all these sports events to open, and we sign up ourselves. Now, however, I've started playing tennis because there's a nearby club. Like near to my home, yeah.
Okay, but in the neighborhood, there are no neighborhood games, no games at the terrace, all that is stopped.
No, yeah, completely stopped. No sign of them.
Are you looking forward to having those matches all over again? Or are you a little scared about the pandemic? Is that sort of casting a shadow over the fun that you probably could have?
No. I'm really looking forward to, playing and experiencing all those things again.
Not scared. Are you going to be, once the vaccine is made available, are you going to be taking the vaccine?
Yes, I'll be taking the vaccine.
You're not scared. You're not scared of the
vaccine. No, I'm not.
That's good. That's a good sign. Let me go back to Dr. Poorna Chandrika. Doc, you mentioned the red flags when we started off this discussion. When should parents actually take their children, either perhaps an online consultation with a psychiatrist, the moment they notice some of these symptoms, or do they just wait and watch for some time? At what stage do you think they should actually intervene and say, look, now we need professional help?
Whenever we, since I also happen to do pediatrics before I switched on to psychiatry, we always keep saying that the mother is the best informant for the child. We always say, listen to the mother. So the parents know best. So whenever we say reassure, but sometimes if the symptoms seem excessive, when the child is sleepless for quite a week or so, if he's very anxious, very irritable, to the extent that the child is not able to concentrate in the daily activities of life, either be it eating or keeps on fuzzing about, which the mother will definitely pick out and say, my child is not okay. So when child is not okay, definitely we are not the first one that they will rush to. They will end up with a general practitioner or a pediatrician who will be the first point of contact. So the pediatrician will definitely pick it up and say that this child is going to the physical signs of stress. That might be a sort of loose stools or a tummy ache or a school phobia when the schools were going on, wherein the child avoids school or excessive clinging on to parents. And if the child has, as I told, with pre-existing mental health issues like an increase of an ADHD, increase of the autistic behavioral, like increased irritability, which the child might undergo because of the undergoing restrictions, and then they pediatrician will definitely refer to us. And also, sometimes when the child is already under the care of a psychiatrist, that is the time we'll be seeing it in the first hand.
What about, bowel and bladder accidents? That they suddenly, yes. The case of incontinence sometimes in children. Some say that it's because they're so excited to be on the computer. Many of them play games now. That my children keep asking me when we have a computer time after, three sessions, three classes. How much should we regulate that?
That's what I'm telling you. Before, as one of the earlier speakers said, before we used to say no mobile, no laptop, nothing, you shall not go near it. But now anything and everything we have to, even online yoga classes, online dance classes, online, everything is online. So the bowel and bladder, once, if it had happened before, and as I said, the mother will be the best informant. If it is a little bit worrying that the child is holding on to the bladder, even refusing to go to take bathroom breaks and sitting in front of the screen, then that it is really a problem, to a concern, and it needs to be addressed. So anything in excess needs to be addressed.
Let's go back to Dr. Madhu. Madhu, vitamin D deficiency, I mean, it could show up in body pain, joint pain and all that, because they're not getting enough sunlight. How many children really able to go to the terrace and, some exercise there, go out for walks? I'm not sure how many parents allow them to do that. Are you seeing a lot of patients who come with vitamin D deficiency?
Good question, Sanjay.
Better now, Madhu, yes.
Better? Okay,
yes, much better. Right.
Yeah. So, as I was saying earlier, I think the biggest adverse effect on children, as the children somehow escape the adverse health effects of the COVID pandemic. But I think what really happened during this time was a bigger pandemic when it came to the pediatric age group, and that is the digital addiction pandemic. And as the other speakers have mentioned, excessive screen time has had a toll on the children's health, mental health and physical health and ophthalmic health, as Dr. Mohan Rajan pointed out. Taking in more calories and opportunity to burn less calories. Anecdotally and also evidence-wise, you have seen that a lot of children during the pandemic period have put on a lot of weight. So this has been a big problem. And specifically to answer your question about vitamin D deficiency, yes, children, the best time for sun exposure to produce vitamin D, your skin is the best factory, the biggest factory for vitamin D. And children need exposure between 11 a.m. and 3 p.m. And that is the
time. Would you recommend to parents that they take their children, let's say, to the terrace or to the gardens, expose them to some sunlight, perhaps the morning sunlight,
for at least
half an hour every day? Is that, or every week at least?
Absolutely, absolutely. See, a lot of parents have misunderstood. In fact, their parents have come and told me that they have restricted the children, not allowing the children to go up to the terrace due to the fear that if they go up to the terrace, they may catch the COVID infection. Contrary to the truth, COVID infection, the risk is actually when you put children in closed spaces, when you take children to air-conditioned malls, when you take children to air-conditioned restaurants, to crowded marketplace. These are the places where you expose children to infection. But the terrace is an absolutely safe place because there's open air, open ventilation, and it's a great place to go when you have a raging pandemic like COVID. So I've been reassuring parents that taking the children to the terrace is not going to harm the children in any way. And children need a lot of sunlight exposure. The best time to get the sunlight exposure when the UV light is maximal is 11 a.m. and 3 p.m.
11 a.m. to 3 p.m., is it?
11 a.m. to 3 p.m., exactly. Not
11 a.m. to 3 p.m.
Yes. And
But what about children playing with their friends, let's say, in a gated community? I know of cases where they have contracted COVID by just playing in the garden, at least early on. Yeah. What about the situation now? I know in Tamil Nadu, at least, reported cases are coming to less than 1,000 soon, and about 150-odd cases in Chennai, for instance. Is it safe now for children to play with each other in a gated community?
Well, I mean, the guideline clearly says that avoid close contact. And the guideline still, it has not changed. Social distancing, 3 to 6 feet, because the guideline still holds good. So, you know, children can, you know, do a lot of playing without being in contact with other children. There are a lot of ways to engage themselves, and we would still, you know, continue to encourage that as long as the guidelines stay in vogue. So we're hoping that as the pandemic dies out, the guidelines will change. We encourage exercise, regular exercise, outdoor activity, and playing without without contact with the other children. They still have to maintain the distance of 3 to 6 feet.
All right. Let me go back to Dr. Mohan Rajan. Doc, you gave us, you said we need to ration the time in front of gadgets for children. Can you give us again, for the benefit of parents and for children who probably listen to a doctor more than their own parents, give us different age groups. Let's say from ages 5 to 10, how long can they spend in front of a laptop or a computer screen, or I mean, or a desktop or a smartphone? Then from, let's say, 10 to 17, can you give us those slabs? What is the safe time that they can actually spend?
Right. You're able to hear me, Sanjay?
Yes, Doc.
Yeah. Okay. Up to the age of 3, absolutely no online classes at all. From 3 to 7, 90 minutes is what is stipulated for them with one break, right? One or two breaks.
90 minutes will probably be two periods with a 10-minute break at least in the middle.
Absolutely. 10-minute break they need. Okay.
And then between... So this is up to what age, sorry, Doc? Up to what age?
3 to 7 or 4 to 7.
4 to 7, which means, okay, up to, I mean, at least up to the second standard or third standard, they need to have only two periods a day, because most periods are 40 minutes. So not more than two periods a day with a 10-hour break at the very least.
10-minute break, yeah.
10-minute break. Yeah.
Between 7 and 12, they can go up till 180 to 240 minutes. That is 3 to 4 hours.
Okay.
With again, 3 to 4 breaks. Very important. Each break 10 to 15 minutes, right? So beyond the age of 12, they can go 5 to 6 hours with a lunch break for about 30 to 45 minutes, right? Again, breaks every 30, 40 minutes. So as Dr. Madhu and Dr. Purna was rightly mentioning, the lack of exposure to sunlight not only gives them vitamin D deficiency, but also increases the incidence of short sight, the refractive errors in children. There is a direct correlation between exposure to sunlight and myopia progression. So that is why we are asking these children to go out and play out in the sun. Even before the COVID pandemic, if you saw, even in 2015-16, we did a study. We found that children hardly go out and play. The outdoor activities for the children are completely become very, very less even before the corona pandemic. The corona pandemic actually made it even worse for the children to go out and play. So going to the terrace, getting exposure to sunlight, because sunlight contains a chemical called dopamine, which prevents actually myopia, retards myopia. So that is an important factor. That is why I tell all the parents, expose the children to sunlight every day, minimum 45 minutes to 1 hour. Every day, go to the terrace, expose. Not only they'll get vitamin D, but they'll also get the fresh air, and they'll also make sure that the myopia does not progress. So before the
would you recommend that once schools reopen for the smaller classes? I know they have been allowed from the 1st of November, but not all schools are really taking up that offer. Would you suggest that all schools, the ones that open at least, should have an eye checkup for all the students when they come, because there could be a lot of damage to their sight because of this constant obsession with gadgets, and of course a need to be hooked onto gadgets all the time for their online classes?
Absolutely, absolutely. In fact, as the president of the Tamil Nadu Ophthalmic Association, I'm starting a program wherein I'm giving vision charts to all the schools, especially the government schools, and because these private schools, they have access to very good eye care any time of this thing, but the government schools and the municipal, we are giving vision charts, training these teachers to find out what exactly is the vision when they come back to the classes. So because there's a huge increase in the amount of the refractive errors we've seen. So this is one area which you need to do. So prior to the corona pandemic, we choose to see this problem only in the software professions who are working from morning to night on the computer, and they're saying they never saw the sunlight or the sunset, and they were working from morning to night. But we are seeing that now in the children. The same problem, we are seeing that in the children. So not only the myopia progression, the refractive errors, the eye dryness, eye allergy, the eye fatigue, the headache, neck pain because of bad posture, behavioral changes. Poorna was rightly telling, behavioral changes, lack of social skills, lack of sleep. All these are is actually a vicious cycle. If you, so it's a complete 360 degree problem, I would say, as far as the coronary
problem. I want to take that question. That's a very valid point, Dr. Dho, to Nandini Sridhar. Nandini, you know, the absence of interpersonal skills, you think that's showing up now during the pandemic because they're only sitting and interacting with the teacher on the computer. Do you think that is something that is really showing up now?
Absolutely, because you see, in offline classes, in a classroom setup, there's more interaction with the teacher as well as your peers, your friends. You see, there's always a discussion, but that is largely reduced during an online session, right? So even if you have doubt, the kids tend to note down the doubts and then probably text the teachers. You see, just something.
It's always the chat box. Doubts raised through the chat box.
Exactly, exactly. There's no personal interaction at all. So that actually, you know, makes them very happy when there's a personal interaction with the teacher as well as the friends. And, you know, in a school setting, it's just not personal interaction, it's an emotional growth. You know, you fight, you quarrel, you make up, you see, you feel sad for your friend. So all that makes up an individual. And this is the foundation years. So I think kids largely missed out on this. I was just listening to Dr. Mohan. Apart from the visual, what the eyes went through, you know, my daughter, she is 17, and she would say, I can't take more than 3 hours of an online class per day.
Okay.
You know, just not watching, but even listening. You see, just listening and there's so much of the information input. She said, you know, after my classes, I feel so heavy. Though she's 17 years and like, you know, rightly said, they can take most probably beyond 3 hours of an online interaction. She was not able to. She would feel very tired, mentally tired, and go and hit the bed.
That's such a valid point you've raised, Nandini. I mean, it completely saps their energy. And there's this fatigue, a sense of fatigue that sets in. We're saying for a 17-year-old girl, 3 hours of online class and that she's had it. It's bursting at the seams. Okay.
And that too, when you are using smaller screens, it's going to be even worse. So that's why I'm suggesting go for the TV mode always, even for the online classes. You can go for the smart TV. Everybody's got a smart TV now, or you can use a Amazon Fire Stick.
Tamil Nadu, we all have free TVs given by the DMK. So I think TVs are not a problem. But Tamil Nadu, Doc, in fact, my wife Vidya was just asking me, just showed me a question, asked me to ask you. You know, when it comes to insomnia, sleeplessness, difficulty in falling asleep at night, most parents, in fact, my wife reads bedtime stories to my kids as opposed to showing them something on the TV. What should be the gap between, you know, screen time? When should we switch off the screen time for them before their bedtime? Would it be a couple of hours? What would you advocate?
You're asking me, Sanjay?
Yes, Doc.
At least 2 to 3 hours before the bedtime.
Okay, so if they go to bed, okay, so which means ideally they go to bed by 9:30 or 10, and then by 7 o'clock, after like 7, no screen time.
By 6 or 7, they have to be completely off the screen. And while they're having the dinner, the entire, there should be what is called green zones in the house during the dinner and during the breakfast and all these areas. And after 6 o'clock, 6:30, completely switch off all the gadgets, everything. That's my opinion.
That's so good. You know, I mean, I can say that now because I'm out of television. So no television, 9 p.m. news for school children. You're very clear about that.
Yeah.
Good. And also they learn how to have a conversation and not have a slagging match. Neelu, I want to come back to you. In terms of, extracurricular activities, I know there are certain things. I mean, I used to mentor kids in public speaking, and now I cannot do that now because it's not possible to do that through the online mode. In terms of extracurricular activities, how have your schools like yours managed?
Before I answer that question, Sanjay, I just want to go further on what they were talking about, especially what Nandini Sridhar was talking about. Children... something that we found from our teachers, one of the things they said, when you spoke about them their interpersonal skills going all right. What actually is happening is one of the things the teacher said is, we spent physical classes telling the children when they were in class to stop talking.
Mm.
Now all they are trying to say is to get the children to talk, to respond.
You know, when we were in school, you know, remember classes. The monitor used to write the names on the boards on the board of those who are talking in class before the teacher arrives.
Exactly. Exactly. And now to get the children to even contribute to the class is so difficult. Right? I also conduct classes. I do.
No, but Nilo, I must say there's also the flip side to it, especially in the smaller classes. My children are, I have twins who are 10 years old. We have the problem where the teachers have this unique problem of students, unmuting and constantly interrupting a class. So you have
true,
both sides.
True, true. I mean, that happens everywhere, to be honest. I've been seeing Sushmita muting a lot of people while we are having this conversation. Right. I'm just giving you a parallel. So the thing is, you were talking about extracurricular activities, right? So now I teach theater to children, I teach drama to children. Now yes. I'm having to do that online. And the most
how challenging is that? Because I put my foot down and I said, look, I can't mentor students in public speaking online. It has to be a physical environment there.
I
but
know.
Theater is pretty similar. So how are you managing that? I'm curious.
In fact, see, like you say, one of the most important things of communication, whether it's theatrical or whether you're doing public speaking, is your body language, right? Mm. Now, it is very difficult to teach body language across the screens. It's very difficult. But there are other ways of enthusing them, trying to bring them into the, to get interested in what we are talking about by multiple different exercises. So we've all had to adapt differently to make it interesting for the students. Now, I will say, however, that I still have a lot of students who haven't rejoined the drama classes that we conduct after the schools shut down, after the lockdowns began, and are still waiting for it to become physical, right? Now, another aspect of these extracurricular activities that you're talking about, the children coming to school, I'm actually looking forward to see what is going to happen on the 1st of November, how many of the children are actually going to come back, right?
Are your schools going to reopen for the smaller classes on the 1st?
Yes, we are.
Parents are okay with that?
No, that's what I said. We'd like to see what is happening. We'd like to see how many actually come. The physical classes for the 9th to 12th itself, we don't have a full complement.
So you have a hybrid system, right? It's an optional.
We
thing.
Have a hybrid system okay. where the classes are conducted in school while the children can watch the same from home as well.
So I must confess, Neelu, for my kids, my wife and I took a stand. They said, even if they make it compulsory, I don't mind my children losing one whole year, but I don't want, this is my personal opinion, I don't want them to take that risk. Still they are vaccinated.
Okay.
But that again, we'll have to wait and see how many parents will be willing to take that risk of vaccination.
Well, there are a lot of parents who are willing to do that. I myself have taken that risk with my son. He's in the 11th standard.
Yeah, we've all taken that. We're among the first to get vaccinated. But when it comes to children, there's always a little reluctance
to
going back to school.
Going back to school.
I want to bring in Aryan here. Let me bring Aryan here because at the end of the day, they are the heart of this entire debate conversation that we're having. They are the biggest stakeholders. Aryan, what are your hobbies now during this pandemic? I'm curious to know. Are you sort of going back to reading, the good old habit of reading? Has your reading now improved? Are you reading more now? What are your hobbies now during this pandemic?
I started a lot of book reading and I finished this excellent book called NDTV Days.
Oh, and, okay. I didn't ask for that plug, but Aryan is saying that. I'm glad.
And I've started participating in a lot of online mock MUNs, like Mock United, Model United Nations. And actually, just now I checked, I have completed around 236 days of me learning French on an app called Duolingo.
Wow.
And
fantastic.
Yeah, that's about it.
That's such a bright boy there, Aryan, as bright as a t-shirt that he's wearing. I mean, imagine, the kind of interest, reading so many books, also learning a new foreign language. That's amazing. Dr. Mohan Rajan, another query for you. How safe is Kindle when it comes to reading? A lot of people read on Kindle. Doc, yeah. Do you think Kindle is all right? How long can they read on Kindle? Because we are talking Kindle plus their online classes.
Absolutely. I think another big problem is because apart from the online classes, I think Purna was mentioning about that, they've got their tuition on the online, their classes are on online. For example, their Bharatanatyam or dance classes, whatever it is, on online. So everything is become online. So Kindle, I would say any near vision or what you call near work for that matter, don't use it for more than 1 to 1.5 hours continuously. Okay. If you're going to have more than 1 to 1.5 hours, you want to continuously read on the gadget or a computer or a laptop, then that is going to have a problem in the eye.
So the what you're saying is for children of higher classes, let's say 15 to 17 or 14 to 17 or teenagers, okay. 3 hours, 2.5 to 3 hours of online classes. And if they have to do Kindle, if they have to read books on Kindle, then you say they'd rather do it over the weekend than during the weekdays.
Absolutely. No, my suggestion is, but nobody is following that. I've suggested to all the schools here, most of the schools, that no homework online.
Okay. Right? That's a big, no big takeaway, online, especially for my media right? colleagues
they
who
have
are
the classes
watching
on,
this. You're saying no homework online. Is.
No homework online. Let the children do something else totally different. Nothing is going to happen if you don't do homework. The world is not going to fall over you. The teachers should understand this. The parents should understand this.
You know, you should be made education minister of the state. or at least, you know, in league with our good friend Mahesh Koyamudi. I think that's a very, very important suggestion coming from an expert. No homework, he says, during this pandemic. No online homework particularly. What about other written work, Doc? Written work and showing it up on the screen when as proof of completion.
Written work to a certain extent, yes. Yes, you can do that. You can do that.
But no online homework is what you're suggesting.
Because the whole day, for example, if you take a 11th standard or 12th standard student, from morning 7 a.m. to night 10 p.m., he is on the computer. Okay? On the screen time, because they have tuition classes, they've got extracurricular activities, everything. If you couple everything together, so I think it's really atrocious, I would say. Yeah.
Let me bring in the parent here, Dr. Nandini Sridhar. Nandini comes to examinations. Dr. Mohan Rajan comes up with a revolutionary idea of no homework, no online homework, at least during the pandemic. What about the sanctity of the examination system? A lot of students can actually end up copying during the exams when they're held online. What has been your experience or any anecdotal evidence that you would like to share with us?
Yes, my experience, I've been having a fantastic time because my child goes to NIOS. Okay, so I feel there's more ownership. Now, during this pandemic, I felt, that's where as a parent, I think you should let the child own up to whatever he is doing, you know, not just being a helicopter parent, not sitting and doing, but this is your work. You need to study, right? So you have enough time for you to study, so you study, okay, if you want to do something for yourself. So I think the time was just right for us to inculcate some very good discipline in the act. And like Dr. Rajan said, I honestly don't like this online homework and online examination. I mean, there was so much that was diluted during this year in terms of education. So it's okay. You've lost 1 year, you've lost 1.5 years, 2 years. Nothing's going to happen. I mean, time lost in academics, probably in a classroom setting, you're going to gain it through something else. You know, like he said, I'm against reading the Kindle. You see, I like the physical book. And this is when my daughter actually picked up many books, because we had stacked up books. So she actually started reading books and completing books. You see, because we had the time. And there were many things she wanted to learn, which we never had the opportunity before. So now they were all available online. You see, she took to painting and she took to, you know, learning a language, like Aryan was telling, learning a new language and attending some stuff, courses, which normally a school child will not have the time to do it. But still online, yeah, I mean, that was one factor there. But then I think we had enough time and, you know, I think it was time for us, a parent, for us to rethink ourselves. I mean, what are we doing with the child by putting him in front of a screen? Or, you know, studies, academics, and write, study, memorize the whole day, the childhood is lost.
But these are the time to stand and stare, as they say, the poem goes, to stand and stare.
Yes.
I think these are new age panelists, really, you know, new age parents, new age doctors, may your tribe increase. And, you know, I would go a step ahead and say no homework, no examinations, and no mathematics after 8th standard. I mean, that I have a vested interest there. Also, Nandini, do you get your son or daughter to also take turns in the kitchen to help out with some household chores? Is that also something that you're seeing?
Absolutely. What is, our children were born with a maid and a cook, you see, because we parents are working. But during
this the reason I'm asking you this is when I was growing up, I come from a very middle-class family and Chennai being known for its water scarcity. I remember carrying pots of water on my shoulder. The kind of work that we did, and I keep telling my children all the time, you know the amount of work that I did as a child. So are you witnessing children actually shying away from household chores where they can actually help out parents?
This is how we actually put it across to them. See, pandemic, we didn't allow our domestic helpers into the house, right?
Yes,
so
yes.
This was the exact opportunity for us to make them share chores, you know, cooking. You know, you do the cooking, do a dish per day. It's okay, the kitchen is in a mess. We'll clean it up. But you do something new, you know, and clean the house. I will sweep and you mop, you know.
Excellent.
I'll wash the clothes and you dry the clothes. Okay, we both sit together and fold the clothes. This was
very important.
Timing.
I hope my children are listening to this. My daughter folds clothes and my son refuses to. And I keep telling him this has to be a gender bender. You have to do something at least.
Yes.
Let me go to Aryan. Aryan, do you do any work at home to help your mother and father, or are you leaving it to the orderlies?
No. I whenever I'm asked to, I really help, my parents. My parents generally don't, disturb me because they say that I'm in 10th grade. But, I'm always...
What is the work you do at home? What are the chores that you do?
Yeah, sometimes I help my mom and or the helper, as mom said. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Oh, okay. I just thought your screen just hanged. I just help my mom, cleaning all the dishes. And I really like to cook, but my mother just tells, you go out of the kitchen, go study. You do those works instead. And actually, initially, when the lockdown was called, and that time there were no helpers. So even I cleaned my own bathroom on my own. So it was like...
Good. That's some beginning. That's some beginning, really. Dr. Purna, here again, I want to bring you in this thing of involving children, incentivizing. Do you think that it's good to actually incentivize children when they do household chores? Because that's a skill that they need to actually pick up. And, if they go abroad tomorrow, they have to fend for themselves. Are you coming across cases where parents complain that their children refuse to move, lift a finger when it comes to household chores?
Sir, there is a different form of sibling rivalry also we are seeing. What sibling rivalry is, I was really very surprised when the first parent came and told me. They are one brother is being given the laptop and one child is being given the mobile phone to attend classes. And at times, they have a bigger screen, I have a smaller screen.
Comparisons.
Now the comparison has gone. She's been given an iPad and I have been given a mobile. That is the comparison I'm seeing nowadays. And the fight also centers around that.
Mm-hmm.
And again, parents are the best role models. And if we start doing the work, they will follow us. So there is no other model.
Doctor, let me push the boundaries of this discussion just a little, because you're talking about mental health of children. What about the mental health of parents? The kind of stress that parents have to go to, especially those who are working from home. One is having to deal with the cooking, having to deal with the office presentations and children screaming in the background, having to help them with their homework because Dr. Mohan Rajan's suggestion is yet to be implemented. What about the mental health of parents? What should they do? How should parents and children unwind during the pandemic for their own sanity?
Mental health of the parents, that's what, good, we'll be able to manage our children. If we are not able to keep our mental health in a proper place, then it is going to reflect on the children and that will lead to a lot of problems. And being a close space, increased frustration, more of conflicts and more of less peace. So
familiarity breeds contempt.
Yes, that is one thing.
As a psychiatrist, what would you recommend, doctor? I mean, some simple measures for people to unwind during the pandemic, which are, ways that are safe.
unwind during the pandemic. I always keep saying when we are working outside, there must be something inside the house which we left long time ago. Be it a little painting, just a little pot, singing, something which we would have left, embroidery or something or the other, which we can start when in home 24/7. And also, let's also give it some space. It's always familiarity breeds contempt, as you say, having a small space to us all throughout the day. And let us also involve children into it. And another one point I'd like to add is, there are information which we have to give the children, but let us not give all the information to the children and create a sort of fear or anxiety in them. It should be clear, factual information and from some neutral news channel and not breaking news every hour and every minute or so. So let us give it in a timed sense.
I am so happy to be away from the breaking news madness, as I call it. Also, Doc, there's another reverse, you know, there's another very strange, unique problem during the pandemic. Like, my wife and I work out of home. One of those guys, I remember last month we had to go to court for a physical hearing. Otherwise, courts now are online, you know, virtual conference. So once we had to go to the court, my children are very restless. What time will you come back? Why are you going? Can't you do it online? So now they actually they cling on to us. And I'm scared that once we have to actually start going out to work, once courts become entirely physical hearing only takes place, then we may have a problem explaining to them that we need to actually go our own ways and we need to fend for ourselves. We need to go and earn our living. The children now are sort of getting very possessive. Is that an issue that you're experiencing? The children are becoming increasingly possessive.
Yes, sir. The excessive clinginess we come across, excessive clinginess, anxiety when the parents are going out. And so they have to be reassured, reassurance, reassurance, reassurance. Tell them the facts. Tell them that this is going to be okay. And a mild form of anxiety and mild fear is okay for you to experience when we are going out. But that should not be the norm and that should not make impede you from carrying out our normal activities. And slowly involve them in the safest way possible of COVID-19 with all the social restrictions in place. Make sure that they are also safe and explain to them and reassure them and involve them in whatever we do. And let us be a role model for them.
Absolutely. That's very well put, Doc. Let's throw open the floor now to questions from the audience. We have parents, we have students, we have several professionals. I saw some very respected names popping up. Does anyone want to ask a question? You can either direct it to me and I will put it on to the current concerned expert, or you can just ask a question in general. We have, I think, another Dr. Vaishnavi Chandramohan, another well-known pediatrician from Rainbow Hospital. Dr. Vaishnavi, could you unmute yourself, please?
Hi. Hello, everyone.
Hi, doctor. Good. So good to have you on the show. Thank you for logging in. Doc, in terms of diet of children during this pandemic, in terms of getting their nutrition, because a lot of snacking is happening, a lot of junk food is because they are all the time. You know, it's also to kill boredom. You can't say anything. They keep coming and asking parents anything to eat. So, what do you suggest in terms of healthy food that healthy snacks that parents can opt for?
Hi everyone. So yes, we are seeing a lot of rise in obesity cases, and also a lot of kids are hooked on junk. Biscuits, they keep snacking on chips and unhealthy stuff. So I would definitely suggest that you keep fruits handy. So that will, cut fruits or even just whole fruit. Children should learn to enjoy fruits, I feel, as well.
Not
as
all do, but Doc, the reality is that all, when you give them fruits, they say, not again.
Oh, right, got it, yeah. No, but, simple snacks would definitely help. You know, you have multigrain crackers, you have our own laddus, which are actually healthy. People look at it in a thing, but homemade laddus, things like ragi laddus, or even trail mix, which we can make ourselves without the preservatives.
What about the stress eating, Doc? Stress eating, to kill boredom, they end up eating.
Yes, that also happens. That, of course, they have to actually let out their stress in different ways. I feel, taking them out for a walk or cycling, that will all definitely help, because they have a lot of energy, and if they don't give vent to the energy, it leads into either addiction with gadgets or stress eating and other things like that. Temper tantrums, all that, we have seen a rise. In fact, I've seen kids who have not even stepped out of their homes or even downstairs, and I feel really bad for them, because absolutely no social interaction or activity at all. So I think definitely parents should take note of it and involve them in a hobby, play a game with them, something or the other.
Ashwini, also a lot of better audio clarity, a lot of children end up wearing their headphones for a long time. Do you think this could lead to certain ENT problems, migraines? Should they dispense with headphones? What would you suggest?
So yes, if possible, but again, the practical reality is that the other sibling will also be attending class, or the parents will be working from home. So yeah, limit it as much as possible wearing headphones just during classes, and for other gaming and, you know, other activities, I think they should take off the headphones, because actually keeping the headphones on will breed a bacteria, like, you know, a bacteria which is normally present in the ear canal will actually increase. That's why we also don't recommend putting cotton wool, because a lot of people have that habit in the winter. They'll put stuff, cotton wool, into the child's ears or their own ears. So we tell them to avoid that for this reason.
That's a very good tip, especially because any ENT related issue could, you know, immediately be viewed to the prism of corona. So that could be another scare. So it's good to stay off that. Thank you very much, Dr. Vaishnavi, for joining us. But several students, I can see several students, Rakshan, Ricky, Jeffrey, Dawal, Nasua, Nitin, Victor. Would you like to unmute yourselves and ask? No penalty here if you unmute. This is not your classroom. Would you like to unmute and ask us questions, ask the doctors questions? Like, disagree with us, students? Aryan, of course, has done a great job representing all your views, but I'd still like to have a bigger cross section. Real classroom, also, this is what happens.
This is exactly what happens.
Otherwise, I'll have to call my 10-year-olds to ask a question. Sanvi and Vildan, do you want to, if you've logged in, do you want to ask a question? Can you switch on your video, Sanvi and Vidhan?
One second.
Yeah.
No, one second.
I'm
unable to direct the camera.
Okay, that's fine. So you can go ahead and ask your question.
For written work, sometimes we have to look at our computer and do the written work because it'll be there. So what about that? Will that not be considered as online homework?
Okay, I'll ask Dr. Mohan Rajan to answer that. Doctor?
Can you just repeat the question, Sanjay?
Just for the written work, she has to look at the computer. For written work, she still has to refer to a computer too. So should we even ban written works, what she's saying? Because you end up still looking at the screen.
Absolutely, absolutely. I think...
Shall we tweak your suggestion and say no homework at all?
No.
And you can start by making your recommendation to PSBB, since you're an alumnus.
Already recommended.
Oh, that's pending. That recommendation is pending. They still have homework. They're doing homework right now.
Absolutely. I think no homework online.
I think that's a big, big takeaway from today's discussion. Because, you know, eminent Dr. Mohan Rajan says no homework for children during the pandemic. I think it makes great sense. It makes a lot of sense what you're saying.
I will tell you, this is going to make a lot of sense, because the whole day they are on online.
Yes.
Okay? This is not an IAS exam or an IPAS exam or whatever it is. Nothing is going to happen.
Doctor, what about this tear fresh, you know, eye drops for kids, Ben, because to lubricate the eyes, do you think it's advisable for parents to use drops for kids, this tear fresh or whatever?
It's very
for children, safe. Is it safe? Is it advisable for children?
Yeah, it is safe. It is advisable for children. If they
every
are,
day, doc, every day parents can use?
Three or four times a day. So that's very important. But to avoid the dryness and also the itching, and because of itching, they keep rubbing the eye. And that can lead to a keratoconus problem. So all this is a vicious cycle. We need to cut off. They can use, especially if children were on the online classes for a longer duration of time.
Okay. We'll throw it open again. We'll give another chance to the students, many of whom have logged in. I don't know if you've got attendance for logging in, or even other parents who have joined in. Any other parents also? I can see some names here. They sound like parents' names. Don't ask me why I'm saying this. Just a hunch.
Sanjay, can I come in?
Yes, please.
Sanjay, my colleague Idrish, who is the communication officer with our UNICEF office, he is ready with your YouTube film. Whenever you want, he can play it.
Sure, perfect. We'll end with that. So if I just give one more shout out to the students who would like to join in. Don't worry, in case anyone takes action against you, you can come to me. I'm a lawyer. I will protect you. Please feel free to ask your questions. This is your chance. This is your platform. This discussion is meant for you. You are the center of this discussion. I would like students to, you don't even have to put up your hand. Straight away, unmute yourself and ask your question. I won't ask you for your school or class, anything that will give your identity away. Please feel free to ask your question. I'm sure you have a lot of doubts. Any student?
While we're waiting, can I say something?
Please, Nilo.
You know, just we were talking about earlier when you were talking about food and we should be eating fruits and what is what Dr. Vaishnavi
Chandramohan, from Rainbow Hospital.
She had mentioned. Now, there is also the culture that they've all gotten so used to, which is the Swiggy culture. The children, they are constantly ordering food. It is easier for the parents who are working online. And they are ordering all kinds of different kind of junk food, from burgers to pizzas, and those are the ones that you keep seeing in the house, judging by the kind of junk we are getting rid of every time, right? Now, that is something I feel is a very big problem. The other thing I worry about is we were also talking about, Dr. Mohan Rajan was talking about everyone in class throughout the day, doing their tuitions, doing their dance class, doing everything. I genuinely fear that this may become a regular practice beyond COVID, in the sense that it is so much easier for parents, it is so much easier for instructors to just do everything online, right? I'm sure, Dr. Purna, you must be doing a lot of online consultations as well, because your patients can't make it.
I am one of those doctors who are very procrastinate that my online consultations disappear. So I prefer offline.
Oh, that is wonderful, because I'm hoping that is what it will be the case. But I also fear for our children. And I think as parents, this pandemic was a fabulous opportunity for us to teach them a lot of other skills, which we are not used to. Like you were talking about, Sanjay, in terms of cooking, in terms of looking after their houses, and at some point they're going to go abroad, they go to study, they're going to live alone, they've got to learn how to do this. We are the one of the few countries who have house help and everything, right? So this was a fabulous opportunity, and I think we took that opportunity with our son, and he's been doing a lot of household chores.
How old is your son, Nilo?
My son is now 16. Right,
okay, so class 11 now, is it?
11, that's right.
Okay, we've got a student 11. Now, somebody has marked their attendance, said this old habits die hard. Crispin, infant, present. Okay, Crispin, would you like to go ahead, please? You're most welcome to ask your question or make your point. You didn't have to ask a question. You can just make your point.
Yes, sir.
Yes, Crispin, you can call me Sanjay. Makes me feel young.
No problem, sir.
Okay, Crispin, go ahead with your question or point, whatever you'd like to say.
I think offline classes is better, sir, than online class.
Why, sir?
100%.
Because of high strain.
Are you attending, or you're in class 9? Are you attending offline classes?
Yes, sir, daily.
Okay, how safe do you feel? Wearing your mask all the time, Crispin?
Yes, sir.
Okay, wearing a mask all the time. All right. Stay safe, Crispin. All the best. Thank you for asking a question. We've got Atri Roy here.
Then also a quick one, sir. My heart also goes out to that lot of unprivileged children, the underprivileged children.
Yes.
The parents who come to me as patients are for some other ailments, they tell me that, madam, let this year go. Once the school opens, then we will think of letting our children join schools. So that is high in the periphery of Chennai. So that is also an issue to be looked into.
We were trying to... our press institute and UNICEF, and be having a discussion about the panelists. We'd even suggested, Sashi Nair suggested, that we get a principal of a corporation school, a government school, but they had certain issues with getting permission. So while they were willing to come, they had certain bureaucratic issues. Let me go back. Thank you, ma'am, for making that point. Atri Roy has put up a hand. This is the new format. Put up your hand. One second, Nilo. I'll go to Atri Roy and then I'll come back to you.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Yes. Actually, I really thought that your suggestion for no homework was wonderful. I wish all of my teachers could hear that.
Excellent. I think some of them, I think Dr. Mohan Rajan has already informed his old school. And I think that should catch on. Maybe that could be a headline really in tomorrow's papers. Doctor suggests no homework. And
breaking,
I think that's something. Maybe we should also file a PIL in court. Are all the doctors here on the show on the same page? Dr. Purna, you also feel no homework during the pandemic?
Definitely.
Yes,
Definitely.
Yes.
Dr. Madhu, Madhu, you feel no homework? Madhu, are you also okay? Your son Guhan should be very happy to hear that.
No exams also, Sanjay.
No exams and no homework. Brilliant. Doctor, you are going to win. You're going to win the elections hands down. Next election. Madhu, no homework, no exams.
No, from me, Sanjay. Definitely, I think kids and parents are going through a lot already. So let's ease at least this burden.
Yeah, because homework actually puts stress on the parents as well, right? That's a valid point, really.
Yeah. And coming to Mr. Neelakantan's, comment about Swiggy, Zomato, I completely agree with him. And I think it's all become a matter of convenience now, where we've just gotten so used to it. So one tip that I would tell parents when they say, oh, he's, you know, because I see like so many kids have just put on like 10 kilos in a year or a year and a half. So they say, oh, he's always wanting to eat this. He's eating this. He's taking it from the cupboard. So one tip I would
say. I have this thing of obesity and putting on weight. It's not just a question of growing out of their uniforms. Do you think early onset of early diabetes, what are the other health risks that associated with obesity or this magnitude? Suddenly putting on 10 kilos in 1 year, what are the other deleterious effects of putting on weight so rapidly for children?
Yeah, so diabetes is in children is different, where it's because of like a genetic sort of thing. It's not so much like how it happens in adults, but they do have increased risk of high lipid levels, like cholesterol levels, and things like even physical and emotional, like they feel they put on weight, they feel a lot of, because Instagram is all about being slim and beautiful and all, so a lot of teenagers are on social media and they're being
also a mental health fallout.
Yes, absolutely, so we're seeing a lot of that, and of course vitamin D deficiency, because nobody's stepping out and getting that. So I prescribe vitamin D to most of the patients who come, especially if they say that the kid has not been out.
What about, children having to go for braces and, for dental treatment, forget the mental health, but also dental treatment. They say that the dentist check would be a bit risky. What would you advise parents? Would you advise them to postpone their visits to the dentist for some time till the situation is brought more under control?
If it is something like a cosmetic problem, then yes.
If it's an elective dental treatment, yes. But if it's a dental caries or infection, then you say yes.
Yeah, if it's an elective or general, yeah, then they should go, because it will actually infect the root, and the tooth that will come after the milk tooth can also be affected. So I would say if there's a caries tooth, you should go in.
All right. Sanjay,
can you hear me now? I'm sorry, you were asking me a question.
Yes, Madhu, are you in America or are you in Madurai? Where are you?
I'm in Madurai.
I'm sorry,
I was actually asking a question. I didn't realize I was muted.
No, technology, we blame it on technology always. We've got a convenient scapegoat.
So I'd like to be the odd person out and say that, I'm not going to say no to homework, because I think children need...
Madhu, we're going to shout you down. I'm
going to lose the election badly. I'm going to get defeated in the election.
No, considering that you have political ambitions, I know.
So I'm going to be unpopular and say that children need homework in moderation, there should not be excessive homework. No torturing, but I think they need some kind of homework in moderation to keep them engaged.
So that Madhu,
productively engaged.
So that Madhu and Chitra can have their romantic moments together, so that the children are occupied. Okay, we have Romina here, who wants to ask a question. Romina, please go ahead. Welcome to the show.
Yeah, my question was, as far as examination system is concerned, do you think that post-COVID, there will be less emphasis on board exams and more emphasis on continuous evaluation through the year? And secondly, will the form of evaluation of our exams or tests be more project-oriented, open book kind of exams, rather than just memorizing of facts and spilling it out, that kind of a thing?
As a parent myself, I think that's a great idea. Let me bounce that off to Nandini Sridhar. Nandini, do you want to take that suggestion? I mean, that's a valid concern, and I think it's also a wish.
Yes, Sanjay. I was very happy that Ravina picked this up. And not only this pandemic has given us time to rethink many things that we've been going through, especially the education system, right? What are we doing with our children is a big question mark we should all be asking ourselves. Right now, when the schools have started to open and it's gently easing, we have one day of school and one day of no school. You see, the kids sit at home to catch up with whatever they studied. I think this is one of the best systems also, right? So, like we say, what are we actually testing our children? Like memory, is it the memory power or is it the learning? Or can they apply what they've learned to life? You know, can they translate that to life? Is it life skills oriented or not? So I think all those we need to rethink now and bring about a change in the educational system. I'm for one, I like what Dr. Rajan said, no homework or less homework, you know, and give the child, their children, their childhood. They need to enjoy
yes.
their, you know.
Restore childhood to children.
Yes.
Absolutely. Rowena, do you also agree that no homework for children? No homework, no exam.
Yes, but not so much as the thing is, when we say homework, we immediately assume it's going to be book and paper. Homework can be different kinds. Homework can be interview your parents on something. Read a book. Homework, and so it's not so much. As I said, when we think homework, when we think exams, we think immediately sit and study, memorize, and put it.
Academic homework.
So
academic.
What I'm looking at is the system of evaluation and examination needs to be changed, where the child's speaking skills, the child's questioning skills, the child's ability to imagine, the creative skills, all of these also play a part, and those are the ones which actually, when you actually go into the job market, is what actually counts. So those skills are, and I'm not saying that memorizing, certain things you do have to memorize. I'm not saying we can eliminate that. But what I mean to say is we don't have to memorize everything. Today, for everything, people go to Google. They go and do a search. The important thing is, how do you use the information that you get to actually solve problems?
Absolutely. You know, the other day I saw a post on LinkedIn, Rowena, where a HR head said that, you know, one of the skills mentioned in a CV is Googling. So the person is actually honest about it, because that's another form of research. Another question that I'd like to ask, we're running out of time right now. We've overshot our time. Of course, we are still within the three-hour ceiling of Dr. Mohan Rajan. Yes, sorry, Neelu.
I just want to respond to what Rowena was just talking about in terms of evaluation, in terms of examinations and stuff. Since I've been closely involved with the schools and watching what is happening, the CBSE now is going in for a more continuous evaluation system, and they are also experimenting this year with two board exams for the 12th standard, which is one in November, which is a completely objective format, and they are doing one more in March, which is the balance that they are going to be questioning them upon, right? So what I am trying to bring across here is that the technological education that's been happening, the online education that has happened, has opened up new vistas, not only for the students, but for the teachers too. The teachers have a lot more tools at their disposal now to be able to impart what they would like to do, teach the children better than they could have before. Our teachers, I've noticed, have upskilled themselves so much better now. And a lot of the children are enjoying the methods, because there's a lot more interaction involved. There is a lot more, audio, video aids that are being used, and different kinds. The technology is giving them the latitude to be able to teach better, right? So I would say that the pandemic has helped the teachers in a lot of ways. And I would also like to respond to Dr. Poorna when she was talking about the underprivileged, when she was saying, those are the ones who want to actually come to school more than the ones. I was speaking about this earlier, if you remember. Our schools, that is the Madras Eva Southern School for the girls.
Let's also remember the midday noon scheme.
Yeah.
Midday meal scheme. Also, you know, for the children from the underprivileged backgrounds. For them, school means a good, nutritious meal.
Exactly. Exactly. It makes a lot of difference to them too. And to be honest, they are coming for almost full days of school, because they are not, they don't have the access to the visual aids, the technological aids that everybody else does. And they want to do so much better. So I'm talking attendance of 95% in those schools, where you're talking attendance, say, in our other schools, the CBSE schools, where the paid privileged, so-called privileged children are there. There the attendance is probably 5%, 10%. There is a huge difference.
That's well put. In fact, one of the things I'm told that, a positive fallout of this pandemic and the lockdown, as far as mental health is concerned, is that a lot of parents today have, they've got over that stigma of taking their children or at least doing consultation with a psychologist when they have certain mental health issues and challenges. I think that's a positive fallout of this pandemic. We'll try and, again, make an attempt to have that video played this time. We'll try and end with that. Vaishnavi says a tip to avoid unhealthy snacking is for younger kids to not stock chips and biscuits. Okay, that's a good tip. Thank you, Vaishnavi. We try and end with that improvised Pink Floyd song, which kind of, in a way, reflects the sentiments of the Aryans on our show. Aryan, thank you all for joining us, all the panelists, all the doctors, parents, for joining us. Thank you, UNICEF and Press Institute of India, for giving us this platform to raise relevant issues in a lot more effective and patient manner, I dare say, than primetime news TV channels. We leave you now with this song. Very, very interesting improvisation. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, for logging in.